I'm Yvonne Mann from Bloomberg TV. I'm joined here by Nuno Matos, HSBC Wealth CEO here in Hong Kong. Nuno, you were appointed to this job earlier this year. What are your ambitions and vision for China and the region for the wealth business?
Well, Asian wealth is our passion, if you want, as simple as that. And I would start by saying that wealth is by far, in the consumer space, the most compelling opportunity for the financial industry, if you want. Okay, and you have some global factors, for example, the expansion of the affluent population. You have low rates for longer, and you have customers very much educated, trying to look for returns, which today don't exist in normal interest rates, right? But then you also have some regional trends, which are very, very clear. Asian wealth is growing twice as fast as the rest of the world. And you know what? We are the Bank of Asia, right? So it's a compelling opportunity for us, if you want.
You have some pretty ambitious plans for hiring in China in particular. You mentioned you wanted to hire 700 wealth managers on the ground by the end of this year. Are you on track to reach that goal?
We are fully on track. Actually, I would say our plan is to hire 3,000 until 2025. That plan is a 5-year plan. It started this year. This year we were planning to hire 500, and we are going to hire 700. So we are actually accelerating our plans in China.
And who are you actually hiring? Is it more about your senior bankers that can help and target some of the ultra high net worth, or is it more about bankers and targeting the more mass affluent?
All of what you said, it's happening at this moment. We are not targeting the mass market in China, it must be said. We are targeting the mass affluent and the high network. So we are hiring private bankers, if you want. We are hiring mass affluent RMs, and we are hiring external sales forces to sell wealth products, example insurance. And we've been doing that very intensively and very successfully.
The political environment, of course, has been quite interesting. And it's developing as we speak, of course. Given what we've seen with China clampdowns, the tensions that we see with the US, what is the sentiment like among your clients right now?
Well, I would say the following. Our clients, in terms of how to invest their assets, are slightly more cautious at this moment. But they are more cautious for real reasons. The pandemic changed the expectations in terms of when the world will go into a full opening, right? Interest rates might be on the rise. We are talking about tapering. Asia as a whole is slowing down a little bit in terms of growth. So I would say it's absolutely normal that our customers became a little bit more defensive. It's not a big change, but undoubtedly they are more cautious. I would say then that we fully believe that they should stay invested because the recovery is real and rates will stay low. But I would say something. In this second phase of the recovery, we need to diversify. Not all assets are going to go up. So we need to diversify and make sure we go for quality assets. You're talking about large caps and high yield dividends, I would go for that.
A common prosperity, that's a big theme in China right now. Have you observed any concerns from your ultra high net worth clients? What questions are they asking you at this point, and how are you advising them during this time?
Well, I would say common prosperity makes absolute sense with Chinese history, right? And you look into the numbers, and it's happening at this moment. I'm talking about the middle class in China is bigger today than the whole US population. 340 million people in China are middle class. In 25 will be 500,000 people. Then if you talk about mass affluent, we're talking about 30 million, and high net worth 2.5 million. So there is space for all. The market is growing astronomically. For a wealth business like us, this is a compelling opportunity. And I think it works well for high net worth, mass affluent, and mass market. They are all looking for investing their wealth, and we are there for them.
And we've seen a lot of nerves in the markets, whether it's on tech crackdowns in China, you have high yield bonds that are pummeling just based on what the Evergrande crisis has been going on. Have you seen any of your clients want to move their capital overseas?
We did not, and I must say that the wealth story in China is absolutely intact. Okay, again, this is happening, this growth is happening by the day. The level of growth of middle class and high net worth population is growing at 9% per year. So we don't see a major displacement of wealth stocks from China outside, even though some will happen, which is normal in a world that wants to diversify their wealth.
Does it in any way impact your ambitions on the mainland?
By no means. We are fully in China. Hey, we are the leading international bank in China, the biggest international bank in China. We hold the biggest number of licenses in China. We have been there since our foundation for 156 years. We want to be there for the next 156 years, fully committed. I will say that if you go to China with a medium short-term approach for the next two quarters, you are in the wrong place. You have to go to China for the long term. That's the right mindset, that's the right approach, and that's what we are doing.
I'm not going to ask you about politics, of course, but of course it has in some way affected your business. There's talks in Hong Kong about a potential anti-sanctions law. We're still not hearing about whether we're going to get it or not. But I have to ask, are you looking at your different clientels now, whether it's the retail side or whether it's on the other side as well, on how you look at clients right now based on what could be coming, this legislation?
Well, let's put it this way. We understand geopolitics. They're obvious. They impact everybody. They impact companies, they impact us, they impact customers. But we know what we can manage and what we cannot manage. What we can manage is our customer business. And that's what we're focused on, managing our customer business and delivering to them the right products and services.
Now, how do you manage it when there's directives from both sides, from legislation from the US as well as China? Is there a way to appease both sides while you do business?
We continue to focus on our customer needs, as simple as that, because that's the only thing we can manage.
Does it change how you view different wealth hubs outside of China, for example, like Singapore? How attractive a market is that for you?
Very attractive, but I would say for us, it's never about Hong Kong or Singapore. For us, it's Hong Kong and Singapore and Asia. It's about winning in Asia. Hong Kong and Singapore, by the way, they are the second and third cross-border markets in globally on the wealth space. We don't want to be out of that. And by the way, they are only below Switzerland. But by 2025, Hong Kong will be the number one cross-border wealth hub. And Singapore is the fastest growing. We want to be there, and we want to do that to connect the world with those wealth hubs. Hong Kong is very important to mainland China, very, very important. And the GBA region initiative is just opening a world of opportunities for us. Singapore is very important for the Asian connectivity, the Asian region connectivity, for the Middle East, and is actually very vibrant as a financial hub. We just recently announced an acquisition in Singapore of AXA, which for us is a tremendous play because we are doubling down on our insurance business. We are getting scale on the life insurance business. We are getting a better position on the health business. And we are getting an external sales force which we didn't have. So for us is Hong Kong, Singapore, and frankly, all the wealth hubs in the world where we are present. And that's what we are doing.
Yeah, your CEO, Noel Quinn, talked about that during the latest earnings report, saying that they're looking at some small bolt-on acquisitions. You mentioned about AXA Singapore. What are some other targets that you're looking at in this region?
Well, I would say the first thing, as an obvious one, 90% of what we are going to do is going to be organic. We have the right to win. We have the customers. We have the segments. We have the capabilities. We are full asset management in place. We have full insurance in place. We have full private banking in place. So we have the right to win just by growing on top of what we are. Having said that, if we look into an opportunity which will accelerate our strategy or will allow us to gain scale in one market, we'll go for it. So we are planning for four or five small bolt-on acquisitions, which will increase our wealth ambitions in our Asian top markets, which I would say are Hong Kong, mainland China, India, and Singapore. I will not tell the names, obviously, but I would say we hope that will happen soon.
Is part of your scope looking at some of these more kind of boutique private banking shops in the region? Is that something that you're looking at as well?
We are not looking for boutiques specifically. We are looking for businesses that will expand our scale in the market. Mm. We are looking for elements that add into our capabilities. I would not call it boutiques. I would call it capabilities expansion of scale. Mm.
Outside of China, we talked a little bit about Singapore, but beyond that, what are some other markets that you think have the most growth runway here right now? What are you most interested in?
So I'll repeat it. In Asia, our top four markets are Hong Kong, and obviously we are the dominant bank in Hong Kong, if you want. It's about mainland China. We are the leading bank in China, international bank in China, if you want. Singapore, we want to continue to grow our already meaningful position in that market. And India It's a huge market. It's a wealth story at this moment. Wealth is growing at 10-20% depending on the industry in India. We have a small presence in India on the wealth side. We want to find our way into a more ambitious size in India.
And what kind of timeline do you have for that? Do you set your targets on that?
We set our targets for the next 5 years, okay? And in the next 5 years, we want to be the leading wealth manager in Asia. And that's a bold ambition we want to deliver.
You mentioned a little bit about kind of your clients are a bit cautious right now, rightfully so. We mentioned about the tension that we're seeing in markets, whether it's, from what we're seeing in China today, we're seeing quite a bit of a sell-off here when it comes to concerns about inflation. What are your wealthy clients investing in particular? Are there specific global trends and regional trends that you're advising them that you're seeing right now?
Yeah, well, I can talk generic about what they are doing, right? But the first thing I would say is that every customer has been anxious to get some returns. In a very low interest rate environment, that's tough, right? And the traditional banking products like a term deposit does not serve anymore to protect your wealth because it just is consumed by inflation, right? So I would say that on the fixed income space, yields are extremely low, that's obvious. There is still some space on the emerging market bonds and on the high yield bonds, okay? And then for the wealthiest customers, a new avenue, which is, if you want, growing by the day, is what we call the alternative space. Which is talking about real estate investments, private equity, private credit, hedge funds. This is a new range of products for that population, ultra high net worth, that is really embracing, if you want, this need for higher returns. Also higher risk, you must say. And then Asian customers, by the way, which were always traditionally very domestic buyers, they are now looking into diversify globally, as they also see the Asian economy slightly going down a little bit, slowing down. But they have been very disciplined in terms of thematic and new economy trends. So they are looking into smart manufacturing, healthcare, renewables, electric vehicles, just to name some of it. Yeah.
ESG?
ESG, I should have said it immediately. It's a wave, by the way. It's an exponential wave that is going through the market. And that's a place where we want to be one of the leader investors, one of the leader providers of sustainable investment for that population. ESG is an obvious need. We know that the planet is not sustainable. The planet needs to be transformed, okay? And this generation, talking about our generation, is called into action. And we have this decision to make, which is, are we going to be the generation that's going to save the planet, or we'll leave it to the next one, which will be too late, to be frank. So our bank takes this very, very seriously. We want to be the one financing the transformation, financing the transition of our customers, companies and individuals. Last year, we announced, for example, our policy, very clear policy. We want to be net zero on our operations by 2030. We want to be net zero on our customer portfolios by 2050. And we are committing to $1 trillion of investments into sustainable investments. What is very curious is that our customers, our consumer customers, are starting to be very much aware of this equation. We did some research. 3 in 4 of our retail customers of all segments, they want to know more about how they can place their money to more sustainable options. And 50% of our wealthier customers, mass affluent customers, they actually believe that in 3 to 5 years, all their holdings will be in sustainable investments. So we are delivering to that. We are creating by the day capabilities, funds, discretionary mandates that only focus on sustainable investment. We are also doing simple things like all our credit cards and debit cards are now in recycled plastic. That will be completed by 2026. Yeah. And we are doing this to become a leading sustainable investment bank. Yeah.
Yeah, you're new to Asia, so I think you're looking at the business in a different lens. I have to ask before we go, the biggest risk to the business right now, what would that be?
Well, the biggest risk is the lack of ambition, which we don't miss. We have a lot of ambition to grow, okay? And then, as I always say, the macroeconomics obviously determine a lot what we can do in banking. But we cannot manage macroeconomics. So we focus again on the things we can manage. And what we can manage in HSBC is the ambition, the passion we have for wealth,
for example. Are you concerned about a slowdown in China that we've seen right now?
China is slowing down slightly. It's a fact. We see that on the PMI and trade data. China also had to restart the economy, or is not restarting the economy because of COVID. So obviously it was expected that China would not pick up in growth. Having said that, we believe that in 2022, China will be growing again above 5%, probably 5.6, which is very respectable. We will see the infrastructure investments going up. We see more fiscal stimulus going into the economy, central and local. So we don't think China will slow down further than what it did. So we are very positive again in China.
Nuno, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.